Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. Our planet's North Magnetic Pole is on the move. According to a recent update to the World Magnetic Model, the movement of the North Magnetic Pole, which has been erratically accelerating for about 40 years, has recently accelerated more dramatically. Of course, planetary scientists attribute changes to our planet's magnetic field to the so-called dynamo deep down in the planet's outer core. However, we have reported on the groundbreaking recent discoveries which completely confound conventional models of planetary magnetic fields. In this episode, we ask Dr. Donald Scott to elaborate how a planet's magnetic field is generated in the electric universe, and how this theoretical model can be scientifically verified.
Earth's magnetic poles have been wandering around since we've been able to measure their locations. That's a long, long time. And actually, several years ago, I remember there was a scientist in Boston who worked for a company there that made marine compasses. And he had a supremely accurate magnetic compass in his lab. And he recorded and made public the daily variation, that is to say, fluctuations, in the direction of the field at this location in Boston. And, of course, Christian Birkeland also described these variations as these wobbles in the magnetic field. He called them magnetic storms, and to this day, that terminology is still used. So he was well aware of this phenomenon. But anyway, the report is about the so-called World Magnetic Model. That's abbreviated WMM. And this is an organization that periodically generates a plot of the magnetic field strength and direction, especially near the Earth's surface at its polar regions. And the latest update revealed the North Magnetic Pole is wandering indeed with a velocity of about 34 miles per year. And that isn't very much, it isn't very fast, but it's fast enough to each year you've got to have a slight micro degree correction in the thing. And apparently, according to the report, it crossed the international date line in 2017, and it's moving out toward from Canada. It's on its way to Siberia. So the South Pole apparently doesn't move that much, the South Magnetic Pole anyway. But I would like to comment on that article, because in the article, it indicates that the recent report states that the cause of Earth's magnetic field is, and I quote, turbulence in Earth's liquid outer core. There's a hot liquid ocean of iron and nickel in the planet's core where the motion generates an electric field. Excuse me, electric field. Okay, we're talking about magnetic field. But no, it generates an electric field. Liquid churning in Earth's core generates most of the magnetic field, which varies over time as the deep flows change. Now, this is certainly false. Magnetic fields are not caused by turbulent molten liquids. They're caused by movement of electric charge. That is a word that I don't believe was incorporated at all in that report. Charge is something that's beyond the pale for these people, I guess. But anyhow, I think in this day and age, the level of ignorance about what causes magnetic and electric fields is at least surprising. And in my humble opinion, it's discouraging. I mean, where do these people go to school? James Clerk Maxwell produced his elegantly exact equations back in the 1800s, and astrophysicists seem unaware of his work even to this day. There was a recent report about Saturn that they were all amazed that the planet should have a geomagnetic field, because the magnetic axis of that field and the axis of rotation of the planet were almost exactly aligned. So what? The axis of the geometric rotation of a planet has nothing to do with its magnetic field structure. Anyhow, in my opinion, the level of understanding of how electric and magnetic fields are generated is as low as it apparently is based on this just released article and the video it refers to. And there's no hope for any model that these WMM people will invent to be accurate if they have no idea, and it's obvious they don't have any idea, of what the causation of a magnetic field is. The point is, it's a firmly established fact that electric fields and magnetic fields are interconnected. They cause each other. They coexist. Magnetic fields create currents, and currents create magnetic fields. Yes, a time-varying magnetic field that links a loop of wire will indeed cause a current to flow in the wire. but an electric current passing through a winding wrapped around a metal core constitutes an electromagnet. There are many thousands of these things, if not millions, of electromagnets in use around the world. It's a true statement that every single magnetic field in the world, in the cosmos, it has to be caused by electric current. There has to be a current there to form it. Then people say, well, what about the bar magnet? What about this horseshoe magnet I got on my desk here? Well, even permanent iron bar magnets that contain so-called remnant magnetism were originally magnetized by electric currents. So in other words, you take an iron bar, wrap a wire around it, put current through the coil, and the core becomes magnetized. And iron is a so-called ferromagnetic material, and there are other materials other than iron but that are ferromagnetic. But that means that it will, if you shut off the excitation, the current excitation, the bar will remain magnetized, and that's called remnant magnetism. Now, that's not a disproof of what I'm saying. That means that, yes, if you have remnant magnetism, you once magnetized that, either you or some natural force put the current there that made those magnets that you mine out of the ground. But anyhow, it's well known that a large Birkeland current comes from the sun and enters both Earth's poles. So in regard to this this model, this Birkeland current is extremely strong, and it's fully capable of creating or at least modifying our geomagnetic field. It's becoming recognized that planets that have their own geomagnetic field, mostly, in fact, probably all of them, have Birkeland currents connecting them to the sun, Saturn, Jupiter, Neptune, Uranus, Earth, but not Mercury and Venus, but because Mercury and Venus don't have their own geocentric magnetic field. So we have to be careful, though, because we tend to say planets need to have a geomagnetic field. I say this all the time. They need to have a geomagnetic field in order to have a Birkeland current connected to them. But perhaps with hindsight, it's more accurate to say any planets that are linked to the sun by a Birkeland current will have a geomagnetic field. So which is the cause and which is the effect? I suspect, although I've been thinking that it's one way, I think it may well be the other, that the Birkeland current is at least partially responsible for the creation of the geomagnetic field. So the fact that the Birkeland current can and does, it's observed to vary in flux and strength and location. So if that's the case, then there's no doubt that the geomagnetic field will be affected.
At the gas giant Jupiter, scientists with NASA's Juno mission were amazed to discover that the planet's tremendous magnetic field is much too irregular to explain by the conventional model of a dynamo deep within the planet. But in the electric universe, the planet's magnetic field is directly linked to the tremendous electric potentials that have now been confirmed. Scientists studying Jupiter's incredible X-ray auroras found, quote, particle signatures of parallel electrical fields over the poles of Jupiter that forced electrons near the poles upward away from the planet, while protons and other ions moved downward into the atmosphere. This massive electric potential, upward of a million electron volts, provides a possible explanation of where the X-ray auroras get their energy. We asked Dr. Scott if this is a confirmation that Jupiter is indeed an electrically charged body.
What goes on at the North Pole of Jupiter, that there are parallel fields going into the North Pole there, and that causes, and they were sort of amazed by this, that electrons were rising, and the positive ions, that is to say the protons, were going down into the planet. And they said, gee, one thing is going in, the other thing's coming out. And my answer is, of course, what else would you expect? The idea of an electric current is the flow of charge and positive charge. So if you have a bunch, let's say a grouping of protons, that is to say positive charges, and they're moving left to right, that constitutes an electric current directed left to right. The current is in the direction of the positive charges. If, in addition to that, or even in replacement of that, you have a bunch of electrons, negative charges, and they're flowing from right to left, that also is equivalent of a positive current left to right. In other words, the direction of the charge reverses, and it's still positive, that would reverse the current. But if you reverse the direction of, let's say, of a flow of positive charges, and also reverse the charge from plus to minus, those two minuses cancel each other out. So just say it in a condensed form. A flow of positive charges in one direction is exactly the equivalent of a bunch of negative charges flowing in exactly the opposite direction. And so those two phenomena are additive. They don't subtract from each other. And that's exactly what an electric field would form. If you have an electric field pointed, let's say, from left to right, you're going to have, throw a positive charge in there, it's going to zip off from left to right. If you have put an electron in there, it's going to go from right to left. So there's nothing really strange at all about that. I've been trying to get across a couple of ideas that I think are extremely important, but they're kind of subtle. If you know the exact structural shape of an electrical current, you can uniquely determine the magnetic field it will cause to exist. But just because you know the exact structural shape of a portion of a magnetic field, you cannot uniquely go back the other way and determine the detailed structure of the electric current that causes it to exist. This is the problem Christian Birkeland had back in the early 1900s. He knew what the magnetic field looked like up there in the north over the northern slopes of Norway, but he couldn't figure out what the exact shape of the current was. We now know what the shape of those Birkeland currents looked like, but that took almost 100 years before somebody figured it out. I submit I had a small hand in doing that. But more than one electric current can produce the same observed magnetic field structure. You say, well, gee, well, what does that undermine what you're saying? No. Because what we're really saying is an electric current must exist somewhere in the neighborhood of a magnetic field, every magnetic field. I sent you a diagram that I captured and inverted from the latest Thunderbolts YouTube video. It gives an indication of what the geomagnetic field around Earth looks like. I put in there that little red circle looks as like where the Earth should be. And the problem that people run into is that they see a two-dimensional diagram of, especially the Earth's plasma sphere with these teardrop shapes going out behind it. If you realize that those are all three-dimensional objects, you've got to be able to make those two-dimensional objects into three-dimensional objects. So the best way, I think, to visualize it is, it's not exact, but it's close enough. A big fat donut, a donut that's so fat that the hole has disappeared. It's all dough, even at the very thin center. And that very thin center where the hole used to be, that's where the Earth sits. And so that's a toroidal magnetic field. And the magnetic field structure comes up around, let's say if you're in the equatorial plane, the magnetic field lines, if you want to think of it that way, are all going from south to north. They come together over the North Pole and then dump down into that sort of lily-shaped cusp in that donut at the top. And they go down through the Earth and from north to south. So the magnetic field within the Earth flows from the north to the south. And then outside the Earth, at the surface of the Earth, the magnetic field is flowing from south to north. So if you realize that the definition of a, quote, North Pole is where the magnetic field enters the solid, the theoretical North Pole of the Earth is really a South Magnetic Pole, which is confusing as all get out, but that's true. We'll leave you with the thought that it's clear that whether or not the flow of electric charges within a planet is turbulent or not turbulent is unimportant. That's not the way magnetic fields are created, by turbulent molten liquid. Magnetic fields are created by electrical currents, nothing else, and that's the way it works.